I was.
Yes, sir. You
ओके
talk.
ओके तो आई वांट टू रिफ्रेश योर मेमोरी रिगार्डिंग द लास्ट लेक्चर. एक्चुअली इन द लास्ट लेक्चर स्टडी वी डिस्कस्ड द एसेंशियल रिक्वायरमेंट फॉर ए वैलिड मैरिज. आई हैव पॉइंटेड आउट देयर आर फाइव एसेंशियल रिक्वायरमेंट फॉर ए वैलिड मैरिज. आउट ऑफ दैट द फर्स्ट वन that was related with the web by monogamy and we have discussed yesterday. So bigamy means actually this is monogamy which is being prescribed, that neither party have any living spouse at the time of marriage. So this is actually called as a monogamy. It is a just reverse to the bigamy word. And I have explained that bigamy includes polygamy and polyandry both. I have also given the instances. Apart from that, I have pointed out that if bigamy has been committed, marriage will be void. And the person who is violating the condition, he will be punished under Section 17 of the Hindu Marriage Act. Section 17 also refer the two more sections. One was 494 of the IPC and another was the 495 of the IPC, where the punishment has been laid down. Apart from that, one more point I have discussed, that why accused of the bigamy, they are not being punished. What the reason behind that? And I have explained with the cases that what is the reason why accused of the bigamy, they are not being punished. After that, I want to take up the second condition for the valid marriage. And the second condition is very clear. What is written? I have pointed out here that the second condition is, or second requirement is, that there must be consent of the parties, and the consent must be valid consent. Here I want to refresh your memory that here the consent required, that is valid consent. You compare this consent with the consent which is required for the contract under the Indian Contract Act. What is required under the contract? In contract, it is required that condition should be free. But here it is written that condition should not be so a condition should be valid one. And the definition which is given, that is not in a positive form. The definition is given in a negative form. Negative means that there are certain three categories which are being laid down, and if the consents are being obtained under these categories, the consent shall not be treated as a valid one. Please go through the section 5, subsection 2. Very clearly mentioned. What is written? It is written that at the time of marriage, either party is incapable to give the valid consent, it in consequence of unsoundness of mind. This is the bare provision which is written. So if you go through the bare provision, that if any party is suffering from unsoundness of mind, if he is suffering, then he cannot give the valid consent. He has been declared as a disqualified. The second is laid down that though he is capable of giving the valid consent, but if that party is suffering from mental disorder of such a kind or to such an extent, that he or she is unfit for marriage and procreation of child. So this is the second element. Second requirement for valid consent is that the party should not suffer with mental disorder. And here kind of mental disorder also mentioned. The kind of mental disorder is that due to that mental disorder, he is not able to, he is unfit for marriage and not able to procreate the child. So this is the second condition. The third condition for the valid consent is, which is also in the negative form, that party has not been, either party has not been suffering, either party has not been suffering from recurrent attack of the insanity. Here word insanity is mentioned. Recurrent attack of insanity. Before 1976, the provision was different. And here the provision was actually in this second part, it was given that if either party is suffering from lunacy or idiocy. But that is being replaced in 1976. And now this section, subsection 2 is being added. And now any person suffering from unsoundness of mind, mental disorder, or suffering from current attack of insanity, then he cannot give a valid consent. Earlier, the word was also apart from insanity. Epilepsy word was there, but epilepsy has been removed in 1999. And single word is there that if either party is suffering from mental insanity. Now, this is open for discussion. This is open for discussion that when we can say that the party is suffering from soundness of mind, soundness of mind definition has not been given. If you go through the provision, unsoundness of mind has not been defined. Mental disorder, no doubt, defined in a limited sense, but not in full sense. Mental disorder of such a kind or to such an extent, such a kind or such an extent that the party is unfit for marriage and procreation of child. So this is actually, which is laid down for a valid consent. Now, here I want to discuss the cases. Cases are also very few on this condition. The reason is that here in India practice is once the marriage has been solemnized, now it is the headache of the husband and husband's family to take care of that. So I think that there are only few cases where actually this is this went to the court of law. Therefore, we have very limited decisions. And I want to refer these decisions. The first decision I want to refer that there is a case of Alka versus Avinash. This is actually Madhya Pradesh High Court decision. Alka versus Avinash. This was the case. And here actually the word unsoundness of mind, it was actually analyzed by the fact of the case. Here actually what was the fact of the case? Here after the marriage, the husband found that wife was not fit in her mental condition because after the bath, she went out from the bathroom without proper dressing. Apart from that, she was also not able to properly dress up. Apart from that, she was also not able to maintain the cooking vessel and also not able to cook properly. And one instance which is given in that case, that one day the wife urinated in the veranda and she was not able to explain that what was the reason why she had urinated in veranda. So these are the facts which were being there. And on this fact, here actually the marriage was declared as voidable marriage. Here one thing mentioned, I have just slipped over. If this condition is being violated, this is sub 5, subsection 2. If this condition is being violated, then what is the consequence of marriage, fate of marriage? The marriage shall be treated as a voidable. Voidable means it is not void. It is not void. Void and able. Able means the parties may able to declare the marriage as a void. It means the parties, if they are desirous to live together, in spite of fact that one party is suffering from any of such mental disorder or unsoundness of mind or insanity, then they are free to live. Law is not going to interfere. They can decide. But once a party initiated the divorce proceeding on the ground that either party is suffering from that weakness, then naturally the marriage may be declared by the court of law as a void. That's why here the marriage, if solemnized and violating of this second condition, the fate of marriage is the voidable one. So in this case also, the wife was being actually declared unsoundness of mind, and the marriage was declared void. Now the second case I want to put before you, and this, the name of the case is Balkrishna versus Lalitha. Here actually the court, Balkrishna versus Lalitha, the court actually interpreted the word. What is the word? Here, whether the word is recoverable or not recoverable, whether it is used, it has not been used, because mental disorder plainly mentioned, unsoundness of mind plainly mentioned, and insanity plainly mentioned. Whether it is recoverable or not recoverable, it is not mentioned in the bare provision. So in this case, actually, the court expressed opinion that it is not necessary that unsoundness of mind should be incurable. It may be curable, it may not be incurable, it is immaterial. And once it is decided that the party is suffering from unsoundness of mind, that is sufficient for declaration of the marriage as a voidable marriage. So that's all about the second condition. And here only few cases are being there. I have given the reason. Under Indian circumstances, most of the parties, they are actually accommodated with the other party. And the marriages are being pulled off. When the marriages are being actually pulled off, the court will not interfere. It is very much that the party should initiate the proceeding. Now the third condition of section 5.
Sir. सर आपने जो बताया कि अनसाउंडनेस ऑफ माइंड उसमें मतलब वो लड़की को हो गया था, बट सर वो इनकेपेबल ऑफ गिविंग वैलिड कंसेंट कैसे होगा उसमें, क्योंकि वैलिड कंसेंट
इसमें
उसका पार्ट है ना.
हाँ, टेल मी. वैलिड कंसेंट मींस अगर व्हाट इज द प्रोविजन, गो थ्रू द प्रोविजन, व्हाट इज रिटन एट द टाइम ऑफ मैरिज.
यस सर.
ओके. इफ आइदर पार्टी is incapable of giving the consent. Why? Either by unsoundness of mind or mental disorder or by insanity. Okay? So once it is found that at the time of marriage the party was suffering from any of these shortcomings, then the marriage may be declared as a void. Are you getting? So here the time, which is very important. It is clearly mentioned at the time of marriage. If it is the post-development, the marriage cannot be declared as a void marriage.
सर जो unsoundness of mind जो court ने decide किया इसमें, वो wife का marriage के बाद की activities को लेकर के decide किया.
activities was actually observed, but see courts found that the bride was suffering from that disease even at the time of marriage. So that's why the decision has been given. Okay, so very important, pinpointed hai. Hindu law is very technical, one try to understand, because every answer is actually given in the bare provision. It is very clear at the time इट मीन्स सपोज एनी वाइफ एनी हस्बैंड हु वाज द अनसाउंड माइंड बिफोर द मैरिज बट एट द टाइम ऑफ मैरिज ही वाज साउंड माइंड देन दिस क्लॉज कैन नॉट बी इनवोक्ड सिमिलरली आल्सो इफ दिस इज द पोस्ट मैरिज डेवलपमेंट देन दिस बेयर प्रोविजन इज नॉट गोइंग टू हेल्प यू तो दिस शुड बी क्लियर इन योर माइंड मैं प्रोसीड फर्दर नाउ The third condition, what is the third condition? This is actually prescribing the age of marriage. It has a long history. Because age of marriage, earlier in the Smriti period, the age of marriage which is prescribed that, actually this Smriti period, it is called as a golden period, no doubt for literature, but for the social development, This period is known as a dark period. Here actually you can get the hymens in the Smritis and here the age laid down for the marriage and that age which is laid down for the marriage, that age is that when there is a symptom of youngness coming out from the body of the boy and the girl. This is marriageable age. The symptoms coming out. Later on, actually, in 1929, there was a struggle, no doubt. And here one legislation came out. I have also referred the name of this legislation when we were discussing the sources of Hindu law. This legislation was the Child Marriage Restraint Act 1929. Child Marriage Restraint Act 1929. Why I am using the word was, I am personally using the word was, because this legislation, this piece of legislation has been repealed. What was the age mentioned in 1929, this enactment? Here actually age mentioned in this enactment, that was 15 and 18. 15 was for the bride and 18 was for bridegroom. Later on, amendment took place. And the age was being increased and the age which was prescribed, that age was for the bride 18 years and for bridegroom 21 years. Why it was being repealed? It is very important to know the reason why it was being repealed. The reason was very obvious. What was the reason? Actually here, if you go through the Child Marriage Restraint Act, if the child marriage, mortality, that is another cause. This was actually cause for putting this enactment, Child Marriage Restraint Act. But what was the cause? Why the Child Marriage Restraint Act was being repealed? My question is different. Why it was repealed? The reason was that actually, if the child marriage took place, this Child Marriage Restraint Act, this put the marriage under the category of a valid marriage. Marriage was treated as a valid under the Child Marriage Restraint Act. So if age has not been fulfilled, either of the girl or of the boy, and the marriage was being solemnized under this enactment, it was put under the category that the marriage was late. Why? Because the society was not developed in 1929. Child marriage were invoked. Invoked majority of the marriages were the child marriages. Then, if the marriage will be declared as a void, then suppose any child born out of that marriage, then what will be the fate of that child? He might become illegitimate. So that's why here, this was actually a piece of legislation which had educated value. Educated value means this piece of legislation actually providing the education to the public at large that child marriage should be avoided. Therefore, here the marriage, if took place under the Child Marriage Restraint Act, the marriage has been categorized as a valid marriage. Then what is the legislation? here actually punishment was being imposed on the persons who were actually responsible for that child marriage. They were being punished. Punishment is being there. So only parties or the guardians of the parties or the purohit who was conducting the marriage, requirement was, or you can say the law was telling that this would be punished. And imprisonment was also very short, 15 days imprisonment. Fine was the meager. That was actually outdated law. Therefore, this Child Marriage Restraint Act, it was being replaced by, this is also called as Sarda Act, no doubt. It is actually the Sarda who has initiated. So in the name of that, this enactment is called as a Sarda Act. Now this enactment is actually replaced and repealed by another enactment, and the name of the enactment is Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006. So please be careful. Here, right now, we have a new enactment dealing with child marriage. What is the name of that this enactment? The name of this enactment is Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006. Now, what are the features? I just want to discuss, then I will compare the difference in between the child marriage and the Prohibition of Child Marriage Act. Here, if you go through the Section 3 of this Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006, the provision is very clear. What is written? If there is any child marriage which is being solemnized, then at the option of the party who is child, the marriage may be declared as a voidable. So under Section 3, Subsection 1 of Prohibition of Child Marriage Act, the provision is very clear. What is written? If any child marriage is being solemnized, then it will be voidable. Voidable at the instance of the party who was a child at the time of marriage. Very clear. So it means now, here you can compare this prohibition of child marriage with the Child Restraint Act. In Child Restraint Act, the marriage was valid. Here the marriage has been declared as a voidable. Voidable means if the parties are tyrants, they can file the suit and get the decree of nullity. Here, proviso also given in the same subsection 1, and it is written where the suit may be filed. Here, it is written that the court where the suit may be filed, that shall not be lower than the district court. So it is very important. Only the district court is entitled to entertain the suit. Now, here, I just pass one very important information. That district court, right now, the family courts are also equivalent to district court. So what is required? Here, either the petition may be filed before the district court or the petition may be filed before the family court. So where the family courts are established, then family courts are the proper court. The petition may be filed. Now what is written in subsection 2? Here subsection 2, it is provides that if the party is the child, then whether the child can file a suit? No. On behalf of that child, the next friend or the guardian, they may file the suit. And here, apart from that guardian and next friend, the child marriage prohibition officer should also be made a party. So this is the subsection 2. And it is pointed out that if the party is the child, then on behalf of that child, either the guardian or the next friend, along with the marriage prohibition officer, child marriage prohibition officer, the suit may be filed. The third part of this section, it is putting the limitation. Limitation means up to what time the suit may be filed. suppose the child marriage has been solemnized, any time the child, the marriage, the suit may be filed for declaration of the child marriage as a void. No. Here the limitation has been put in the third part. What is limitation? Here limitation is the child marriage when solemnized, it may be challenged before the court of law, and the court of law may declare it as a nullity. Up to what time? When that child, who was the child at the time of marriage, attains the majority, and after attaining the majority, 2 years more. So here the provision is very clear. After completion of 2 years of attaining the majority. It means that after attaining the majority, majority means 16 years, and 2 years, here means up to the 20 years, or the parties are free to file the suit. But one anomaly I want to put before you. What is the minimum age for the bride? 21 years. And bride when attain the majority? 18 years. On a 10 year, the bridegroom, he will be the major. 2 year more means? 2 year more means that is up to 20. He can very well file the suit. So this is the anomaly. Here this is the drafting mistake. Here 21 year up to 21 year, the bridegroom has been treated as a child. And here the limitation is being put on attaining the majority. Majority can be attained by a person on 18 year. So that's why this is an anomaly, you may point. Now, so far as the subsection 4 of this section, here the provision is that while granting the decree of nullity on this ground, the court required the parties to the marriage that they should return to the other parties all valuables, money, ornament which they received or gift which they received during the marriage. So this is also very important. While passing the decree of the nullity, here the court may require the parties that the parties may return back the valuable, money, gift, ornament which they received during the marriage. Here, one more clause is being added, that is in form of the proviso. And this proviso is that before declaring the marriage as a nullity, here show cause notice required to be given. Show cause notice means a notice should be given to the other parties that why the marriage should not be declared as a voidable marriage. So this show cause notice provision is also required to be given. So this is all about the section 3. And moreover, section 3, you can very well mention that this is actually the fate of marriage is being decided. Child marriage, what is the fate? The marriage has been categorized as a voidable marriage. Now I am proceeding towards the section 4. Section 4 is in relation. Why the majority age is 21 and 18? This is not majority age. Majority age is only 18. This is the child marriage. If you go through the definition which is given under this enactment of the child marriage, this is the, it means what? A person who, if male has not completed 21 years age, and if female not completed the 18 year of age. Go through the section 2, clause A. You can get the child, definition of the child is given. So far attaining the majority is concerned, there is no doubt. Aray bhai, why the difference is? This is very, you can say, this is the tradition, Indian tradition. Mostly the brides, their age are comparatively lesser in compared to bridegrooms. The same tendency has been maintained. So that's why difference of age is being given. Now, I am proceeding towards the section 4. And the section 4 is in relation to maintenance of the female female, female means bride. So here, the provision of section 3 is very clear that while granting the decree of nullity, the district court may either by interim order or by final order may pass the order that contracting party, who are the male, or if the contracting party is the minor, male contracting party is minor, his guardian, he is bound to give the maintenance to the female. Female means bride. So the provision of section 4 is very clear. Here it is providing the maintenance provision for the bride. Maintenance provision of the bride means, suppose the marriage took place and the marriage was the child marriage, and suppose the marriage has been dissolved or nullity, decree of nullity has been passed, then from where that bride will get the maintenance? So that's why the provision is being made here under section 4, that bride who is unable to get the maintenance, she can get the maintenance from whom? From the husband. If the husband is minor, then she can get the maintenance from the guardian of the husband. Now, what will be the quantum of maintenance? This is the subsection 2 of the section 4. The quantum shall be decided by district court. District means family court. So here the quantum shall be decided, and while deciding the quantum, certain factors are required to also keep in mind. What are these factors? Need of the child, lifestyle of the child, and third one, that is the means of income of paying party. So three factors shall be kept in mind by the court while deciding the maintenance of the wife. First, what is the need of the wife? Second, what is the lifestyle which enjoyed by that girl, that bride? And third one, what is the capacity of the person who is going to pay the maintenance? All three shall be taken together, and this maintenance amount shall be fixed. This maintenance amount may be either in lump sum or it will be monthly, as written in third part of the section 4. So either it will be in lump sum or it will be monthly. Lump sum means ya to ek saath jo hai payment ho jaye, ya jo hai mahine mahine payment hota rahe. Iska chautha part important hai. Suppose any wife who is being married and the marriage has been declared as voidable, nullity decree has been passed, where she will reside? Because in the father's family, she is not entitled to reside there. And where she will go? So that's why the fourth part is very important. What is written? Here it is written that the bride has a right to reside in the house of the husband. Now she is entitled to reside in the house of husband till her remarriage. जब तक उसका रीमैरिज नहीं हो जाता तब तक वो हस्बैंड के मकान में रहने की एंटाइटल्ड है. नाउ द सेक्शन 5, इट इज रिलेटिंग टू द कस्टडी ऑफ द चाइल्ड. दिस इज आल्सो वन ऑफ दिस थिंग्स व्हिच वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. सम टाइम व्हाट हैपेंस, द चाइल्ड मैरिज नो डाउट सोलेमनाइज्ड, एंड सपोज एनी चिल्ड्रन बॉर्न आउट ऑफ दैट चाइल्ड मैरिज, बिकॉज चाइल्ड मैरिज एज इज 18 एंड 21. And so far as the development, genetical development of the girls and the boys are concerned, they become genetically competent to procreate the child. Particularly in the girls, it is 14 or 15 years of age. And particularly in the boys, it is round about 18. So now, when both are competent to procreate, even though they are declared as a child, but it is possible that the children may be born out from that child marriage. Now, the custody, who will decide the custody question? Here, power is given to the district court. The district court shall decide that which which parent may take the custody of the child. Custody no doubt given to any of the parent, but so far as other parent is concerned, he has a right to assess in a proper appropriate time. So this is very important. So far as the custody, it may be given to one party, but the assess is given to another party. In a reasonable time, the other party has the assess to see the child. What is the paramount consideration? Paramount consideration, actually, this is the interest of the child. When the custody is being decided by district court, here, the interest of the child shall be taken to be a paramount consideration. And when the assess is given to the other parties, then again the interest of the child shall be taken seriously, and this shall also be considered. So the assess, that is also a very important part. Now, so far as the section 6 is concerned, section 6 is regarding the legitimacy of the child born out of the child marriage. So any child which is born out of the child marriage, either before the commencement of this enactment or after the commencement of this enactment. This is very important. Either before the commencement of this enactment or after the commencement of this enactment, if any child is born out of child marriage, then under section 6, legitimacy has been provided. This is very important. Otherwise, what happens? If the marriage will be declared nullity, then what will be the fate of that child? So that why the child is declared as a legitimate child of that party who were party in the child marriage. Now, after that, section 9 is relevant. And here, section 9, the provision is written that if any adult male, if he is marrying, he is a marrying with any girl who is child. It means a person who is adult, who has completed a teen year. If he is marrying with a child marriage, then here punishment is imposed. And this punishment is very severe. 2 year rigorous imprisonment or 1 lakh fine or both. So this is very severe punishment which is imposed under this enactment. So section 9 is very relevant. Any adult male who is contracting the marriage of any child, then here he shall be liable for punishment. And the punishment is severe punishment. Punishment is not normal. The punishment is 2 year rigorous imprisonment or fine or both. Section 10 is also relevant in this regard. Why? The persons who are either abetting, conducting, or performing the marriage. Words are very clear. Try to catch out the word, section 11. Any person who is performing the marriage, performs the marriage. Performing means purohit, is performing the marriage. The second word which is very important in this regard is conduct, conducting the marriage, guardians. The third one, that is abetting, those person who are abetting the marriage. Then they are here required to be punished. I am not getting your question. Aditya, what is your question? Please tell.
Sir, section 9 mein jo likha hai, this act mein. उसमें पनिशमेंट बेसिकली अडल्ट मेल के लिए है, अगर माइनर गर्ल्स
अडल्ट मेल के लिए ही है. दैट्स व्हाई आई एम पॉइंटिंग आउट इफ एनी पर्सन हु इज एडल्ट, हु इज मेजर कंप्लीटिंग 18 ईयर, इफ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट्स द चाइल्ड मैरिज, ही विल बी पनिश्ड. ट्राई टू कैच माय लैंग्वेज.
बट सर, ऐसा फीमेल के केस में भी तो हो सकता है कि अडल्ट फीमेल हो और माइनर बॉय.
बट इट हैज नॉट बीन डेड. What is the reason?
Yes, sir. Tell me the reason. I don't know, sir.
Because actually, what is the objective of the law? What is the objective of law? To remove injustice. And mostly the objective of the law is to protect the weaker section of society. तो दैट्स व्हाई वीमेन हैज बीन कैटेगराइज्ड एज ए वीकर सेक्शन ऑफ सोसाइटी. द ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ द लॉ टू प्रोटेक्ट द वीमेन. That's why here the punishment imposed. But if there is a condition vice versa, as you are telling, female, suppose she is of more than 18 year and contracting a marriage with a child. Child means suppose the bridegroom or the boy was 15 year. Whether the provision will apply? Provision certainly will not apply, because section 9, what is written? If you go through the adult. Male adult, section 9 will not apply. So therefore, under this, because female has been treated as a weaker section of society. May I proceed further? Yes, now sir. Here actually section, anything, section 10, it is actually punishing the person who are responsible for performing, conducting, or abetting the child marriage. Punishment again been given. What is the amount of the punishment? Again, severe punishment. Here the word is and. 2 year rigorous imprisonment. I am not getting your question actually. When I was reading the question, it was disappeared. Please directly come with voice. Who has asked the question, please come with voice. No? Okay. Now, what is the amount of the punishment? Rigorous imprisonment of 2 years and fine of 1 lakh. So those who are found guilty, either performing, conducting or abetting the child marriage, here rigorous imprisonment is being actually imposed. Now, apart from that, another section which is very important, that is section 12. Section 12, actually, there is another kind of marriage which is being categorized. And that marriage has been declared as a void, not void. If there is a child marriage, fate of the marriage is being declared under section 3 as a voidable. Are you getting this? But here section 12, here there is another kind of the marriage. This is also no doubt child marriage. And if any child who is being taken or enticed from the custody of the guardian, words are very clear. So any child who is being enticed or taken from the legal guardianship, or the second, or if any child who is forced to compel or by any deceitful man induced to go from one place to another place. And the third one, that is, if the child is sold for the marriage. So this is actually, if any child who is being transported for the marriage. So if any child who is transported for the marriage, either by taken away or by forced, or by sale, then the marriage has been categorized as a void marriage. Most of you belongs to, okay, two questions remain I want to discuss. Firstly, I want to discuss it. If any child who is being taken away, enticed or forced, compelled to come out from the guardianship of the legal guardian, and he is being sold for the marriage, or she is being sold for the marriage, then here, the trafficking, you can say, this is the trafficking of the human being. And here marriage has been categorized as a null and void. I just put the two instances before you. One instance, it is on the section 10. Any person who directs को परफॉर्म आर गेटिंग माई क्वेश्चन वेदर द बराती से मे ऑल्सो बी कॉल्ड एज अ बेटर बिकॉज ही इज पार्टिसिपेटिंग. क्यों भाई? नो मोहित कुमार, दिस इज नॉट बराती इज ओनली कन्फाइनिंग अप टू द टू पूरीज. And Bharati may say that he was not knowing that the parties were child. He may defend this. The only participation of the Bharatis, he will not be punished. The second question I want to put, it is in relation to section 12, particularly in Bihar. Here actually, there is a concept of marriage and that marriage is called as Pakadua marriage. Those persons who are coming from the Bihar side, they are knowing well. If any bridegroom who is upsettled, it might be possible that he may be kidnapped. And the marriage usually solemnized, and after the marriage, he has been left free. The question is whether Section 12 will attract or not. Any person? Can give the answer?
Yes, sir. Minor girl ke case pe lagega.
No. My question is different. This is actually question which I am putting before you. The practice in the Bihar is that the boy is being kidnapped, not the girl is being kidnapped.
No, sir.
No, you are wrong, Aditya. Go through the bare provision. What is written?
Objection for the purpose of marriage, sir.
Nahi. A child, what is child? It is neither qualified by male or not female. Go through the provision of section 12. Very clear it. Which is being actually common in the Bihar, naturally this provision will attract. One last provision I want to discuss in this regard is section 13. Here the power is given to the magistrate first class or the metropolitan magistrate to pass an injunction. Injunction means to pass an injunction, child marriage. Child marriage should not be passed. So here the power to pass the injunction. Injunction means not restraint. Injunction means actually there are different kind of injunction. There are certain injunctions which are being actually passed by the court to do something. Certain injunctions are also passed by the court not to do something. So here, the injunction which I am talking regarding the section 13, it is not to do something. Power is given magistrate first class or metropolitan magistrate. When he got the information by any source, either from the marriage prohibition officer or any other source, he may pass the order of injunction. And after the injunction, and the marriage naturally will be the void marriage. So this is all about this provision of Child Marriage Act. Those persons.
Sir, can you please repeat? Your voice broke down, sir. Your voice got broken down, sir. Can you please repeat, sir?
Broken down means what? I'm not getting.
Sir, you were not able to hear, sir.
No. I am hearing your voice, but your question is not clear.
Sir, please repeat.
Say what you want to say.
Sir, please repeat it, sir.
My question is very clear. Here, injunction may be passed by two courts. Either magistrate first class or metropolitan magistrate. Metropolitan means if the city is metropolitan city, metropolitan magistrate. If the city is not metropolitan, first class magistrate, it has the power to issue the injunction. Where he got the information, either from the child marriage prohibition officer or by any source, that any child marriage is going to be solemnized, then the magistrate may pass the injunction. And once the injunction has been passed, the marriage cannot be solemnized. It has a two effect. One, the marriage will be categorized as a void after issuing the injunction. And the second thing, this will also amount to contempt of court. So that's all about the third condition. I just want to inform you that those persons who are preparing for judicial examinations or any competitive examination, please thoroughly go through the prohibition of Child Marriage Act. And you should be also able to differentiate between the previous law means Child Marriage Restraint Act 1929. Present law, it means this is the prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006. So this is very important. You should go seriously on this point, because this is the point which may be asked in your competitive examination and also in your LLB examination. Any more question having any person?
Sir, unfit for marriage ka matlab kya hoga?
Unfit for marriage means he is not able to consummate the marriage, either girl or the boy. I will discuss it in detail when I will take up the voidable marriage. In voidable marriage, there is one provision: if the parties are not in a position to consummate the marriage. So I will explain at that time. Right now, you can very well understand they are unfit for marriage. It means that sexual organs are not being developed, suffering from any disease. Any more question?
Sir, I have a question regarding the age, sir. The provision mentioned the 18 and 20 year age. Sir, why this age is not violate the Article 14 of the Constitution?
No, Article 14. This is Article 14. Why it is made? Article 14 alone cannot be read. And moreover, when you are raising the question of Article 14, then reasonable classification permitted under the Article 14. Reasonable classification may be made on the basis of geographical condition, physical condition. The physical condition of female is not the same as the physical condition of the male. That's why this is the different. And this does not attract the Article 14. And moreover, one provision also of Constitution 15.3, Parliament may legislate any law in favor of female. Very clearly mentioned. Okay, so now this is right time to disconnect. A special provision for women. This is mentioned in 15.3.
Sir, one another question regarding the sir guardianship, where you mentioned that sir, if the child is girl and she is married, thereafter the guardianship is to the boy's parties. Sir, is it the child thereafter? Why the guardianship is to the boy? Sir, it should be the father of the girl is to be the better, sir, if that possible.
No, I am not getting your question. Actually, some echo is coming out. Please repeat your question again.
Sir, you are saying that guardianship is given to the boy's side, means the husband has the right to.
I have not told that guardianship should be given only to the male side. Guardianship may also be given to the either male or the female. What is the thing which is required to be kept? That is, interest of the child shall be taken paramount consideration, where the child will be brought up very easily. Guardianship given to that spouse.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So now the connect